confirmation, someone sharing before me in the Afrikaans service as well, a few things. And I want to start with a story or two. I want to share it a little bit this morning on being honest. Honest with God, honest with ourselves, being honest with the people around us. And I just want to pause there for a moment. If you already are switching off and the screensaver are going on because it's warm, I'm going to try and keep it short. Maybe you think that it's okay, it's for someone else. Then I really want you to listen specifically. I remember I've got a, you know, that old parka bike. Is, I think, Bernard, you've got one that looks like that. It's a German flag here. I bought one many, many moons ago. And it had a hole here. So when my boys, the twins, when they were young, I remember I had the story I told them the day when I fought with a lion, you know, and I got the lion around the neck and we fought, and eventually the lion scratched me, and then I overcome and I killed the lion, and the only thing the lion, I could see its eyes, and you know, the smell its breath, and it was terrible, but eventually I shot it here with my gun, and the bigger they got, the more I had to, you know, lie to tell them the story. And obviously, as young boys are, when they were 2 or 3 years old, they kind of believed me. But that lasted only for a season. But the thing is that I remember I wasn't thinking about the lion story. I wasn't thinking about the jacket I had or anything like that. I remember I was sitting one morning having quiet time. And I remember that the Lord brought this thing back to me and He said, "You're teaching your children to lie. You're teaching them to believe a lie, because if you, as a father," obviously the older they got, they kind of 2 plus 2 is 4, you know, they saw it. I didn't really fought with a lion, it was just one of those fisherman stories type of things. Obviously my intention wasn't to sin or to lie or anything, but it's wrong. Because if I, as their father, tell them, listen, if I sell them a lie and they believe it, then they actually, yeah, it's okay to do something like that. How ridiculous the story even was. And especially, so I felt convicted even with that nice father-son fisherman type of story that I kind of told to them at that stage. I felt convicted. And I said to them, "No, boys, it's actually called lying. It's not a joke. Yes, it sounds like one, but it's wrong. Dad did it for, it's just old. It's not the old bike. It's just the old jacket. There was no hyenas or anything like that in the story." And the thing is, you know, when children are young, I think most of us, if we're honest, we will remember somewhere in our childhood what happened when we lied to our parents. They might have been quite hard on us. You know, when we got caught out, I once sat with a real godly man and I asked him advice, you know, about parenting, and he raised 2 sons, which are really awesome young men today. And I remember he shared the truth with me. He said to me, that, you know, whenever his boys came to him and they spoke the truth and they were in trouble, or whenever they were in trouble, but they spoke the truth, he said to them, "Listen, we can make a plan. I can help you." But when they were lying, he said to them, "Now you're on your own. Now you have to deal with it yourselves." And this, I remember Gustav, my one boy, who was really small. And, you know, sometimes some stuff in the house is just gone. It's like raptured or something. It's gone. And he went to his mum and he said, "Mum, that blue ball of mine, I can find it nowhere." But we know the ball has been there a day or two ago. And I remember my wife said, "Okay, she's going to walk with him." And then, you know, kids' hearts are pure, and I believe they don't want to lie when they're young. But I remember my wife took him by the hand and they walked through the house, because they're going to find this ball now, because she told him, "Listen, you're just looking into your own eyelids. It must be there somewhere." And they eventually came to Ulrike's room, and there the blue ball was. And she asked him, "But did you look here? Why didn't you see it? And he just told his mom, "I probably blinked my eyes at that moment when I was looking there." And Afrikaans, I did say, "Oor geknip, mama." At that moment, he was searching there. But people, yeah, I believe it's about the truth. And if I were to phone our other pastor, I mean, we all know it's a long weekend, Tuesday's a public holiday, and it's beautiful weather. And if I were to phone Yaku and told him, "Listen, the whole of Swakopmund were here, the church was really full," then it might be a way of expressing and saying there's a lot of people in church. But it's obviously not the truth. And we need to be careful how we tell stuff. If you say, no, there was no one, if there was only a handful of people in church, and so that long began, we say, ach, there was almost no one. Not true, there's probably 40 people sitting here, 50 people sitting in church. So we need to, whatever we show to our children, especially at home, we need to be really careful about what we tell them. And Jesus had this story in Matthew 5, verse 33 to 37. And as you would see, because of the power failure, there will not be slides this morning. And I'll appreciate the fans a lot next time when we have church and they are, but that gives us grateful hearts. Jesus had the same thing. And there must always be a reason when Jesus shares a parable or he teaches something in the Word. Here in Matthew 5, verse 33, I'm just going to share from that. Now, who of you read those Asterix and Obelix books when you were a child? I loved it. I loved the way they hunted the wild boars and fought with the Romans. And I believe when I was a child, it was just a fun books to read. Now, I remember they always swear by all these Roman gods, all by totus and by this and by that, you know. And here, Jesus is very clear. He said to his disciples, listen, guys, your character should be of such a place of integrity that whenever you say yes, that your yes is your yes and that your no is your no. What do we do sometimes in life? We say, Bernard, I'm going to share something. Me and Bernard is having a coffee. And then I will say, but Bernard, I'm going to be very honest now with you. Now, what are we the rest of the time, you know? Or we use phrases like that, and we say, but listen, I'm going to speak the truth right now. What are you doing the rest of the time? You know? So, it's this morning my heart is, I just sensed, and it was something for me at the men's camp. I just once again saw that whenever we are honest, especially with God, okay, let me just take one step back. I believe, who's the people we're lying to the most? Who said it? Ourselves. I think we have this thing about me and myself. Okay? Stuff is happening in our lives. So me says to myself, it's okay. You're at home. No one will see you. You're alone at the office. Whatever you saw, whatever you thought, whatever you did, it's between me and myself. It's a safe place. And then what's the second thing we usually do when you're at a place like that? We justify why it's okay. I said that word or I had this thought because someone never does that or someone did this. And we have that place where we basically justify our own sins. When something happened here in public and you stand up and you say, I don't like this church because it's too hot and you walk out. Then everyone saw it, it's there. But this thing that happened in our hearts, that's a challenging one. That's a dangerous place. You know, God's omnipresence says that God does not have spatial dimensions and is present everywhere with his full whole being. God, all of God, is present everywhere all the time. Now, our minds can't really comprehend that. We can't really perceive what that really, really means because God is big, you know. But you know, what's the use of lying to God if Scripture says he's there all the time with his full being? He knows everything about the past, about the present, and about the future. When we are honest with God, it's not about telling God so that God can know what's happening in our lives. He already knows. It's holding a mirror in front of us that we can sometimes see what's happening in our own lives. Because the easiest thing is to do whenever there's an issue is to say something like, God, you know, I'm afraid someone will figure out what I did 10 years ago. What will my small group facilitate? What will my husband or wife? Because I will say it this morning. I'm sure that especially those of us that's a bit younger, the young ones, you've got still time to make wise decisions. But for a lot of us, somewhere in our lives, something happened where you watched something, you did something, you said something, or you were part of something that you are really, really ashamed of. That you hope no one will ever find out about that stuff. Only me? Okay? There's stuff like that. There's always stuff like that. And the thing is, sometimes we're so afraid to bring those things to God that we even want to hide it from God. But then the sad thing is we also don't get healing. Because we put it away there somewhere far, far away where no one can sense or see it. But it's like a ball and chain. It's keeping you back. It's holding you back. It's maybe even influencing the way you act or the way you deal with certain things in our lives. Now, when I look at Scripture, there's one man, especially, that's written in about him in different books of the Bible. And that's the life of David. We see in different books, in the Psalms, and when we... I feel like someone that's going to have a short circuit because I've got two mics today. We're trying to record everything in all the volume, but that's on the side. We see in the life of David how honest, how brutally honest he is about his own sins, about his fears, about the stuff happening in his life. Okay? David was a man after God's heart. And David is such a good example for us how he didn't just hit some things there, somewhere in a corner of his life. He was always God. I just want to, Psalm 31, Psalm 32. My eyes is wasted from grief. I have forgotten like, I have been forgotten like one who has died. I hear whispering of many. They scheme against me. They plot to take my life. Let me not be put to shame. Day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength is dried up. Just in Psalm 2, we can see how David is like, God, I'm afraid. God, they are conspiring against me. God, this or God, that. He was so transparent. And that's something I value so much about the Word of God. That Scripture doesn't just hide everything about Samson and Daniel and Noah or Jonah or whoever it might be. Scripture is open. And it invites us into those people's lives, even where they fail. We see of the mighty works that God did through their lives. But we also see the things where they got it wrong. The things where they failed. Where they sinned. So, especially here in David's life, I believe we can so learn so much about his transparency. About his openness and his honesty before God, and sharing on that. Church, I believe the first and the biggest and the most important thing that we all have to be honest somewhere in our lives, especially for us as the church, I believe many of you already came to that place, is someday and sometime you're going to be confronted with the gospel, with the truth. And you have to acknowledge that you are and I am a sinner in need of a Savior. Basically, that we're in trouble. Okay, and that's a big moment of honesty. And if I were to give you examples, and it's always beautiful to listen to people's testimonies and how they came to Christ, but it's usually an onloop. There's usually a lot of stuff happening in our lives, and God and the Holy Spirit working in our lives until we get to that place and to say, God, I can see this thing. God, you've opened, you regenerated my heart, and you made it possible for me to see that I'm a sinner. And now through conversion, I say, yes, Lord, I'm in need of a Savior. Please save me. And we repent of our past and everything. That's probably the biggest place to be really, really honest. And to say that, God, no matter how many times I go to church, how many I give, how good person I'm trying to be, we'll never make it. We have to be honest. There's one way, and that is through salvation. I believe there's so many people, many things, we ask the question now, what should we be honest about? And I'll give the punchline now, because I think some of you are going to fall asleep in 10 minutes time, because it's really hot, okay? It's not about the church's name, it's not about the sermon, it's not about what happened here today. It's about when you and I leave church today, that it will be a bigger place in our lives to say, God, I want to be honest with you. God, I want to be honest with myself. God, I want to be honest with the people around me. Because you all know, you've somewhere in your life probably been to a small group, and we ask each other, how are you tonight? No, I'm fine. How are you doing? No, it's a bit cold, but otherwise it's okay. And we go to the other one, and how are you doing? But those nights when someone stands up and says, please, guys, my life is falling apart, in this time for other people to be honest as well. Usually it's like a dam wall that's breaking. When someone has the courage, or to say it plainly, sometimes we're just too so fed up with ourselves to say, I hate this sin so much, I hate what I'm doing in my life right now so much, that I just have to be honest, and it's messy. But there's deliverance happening. There's a lot of healing happening when we can be honest with ourselves and the people around us. When we have this mask of, now I'm okay, but meantime you're hurting so much, but we're okay, we can go on for a lifetime like that and never ever receive that healing that God really wants us to give. Why do we battle many times to be honest? I think one of the first things that came to my heart is shame. Sometimes we are afraid to be honest because we're so afraid what people will think about me. If I confess what I did last week or 10 years ago, what will people think of me? And I can tell you one thing, especially you young boys sitting at the back, remember it always. Whatever you do in this life, it will not shock God. Jesus made provision for that on the cross.
Amen.
He will never leave you nor forsake you. If you, sometimes we feel that after we've sinned and we feel dirty, we feel that we even can't go to God and we don't want to pray or worship because we feel kind of contaminated or dirty. Okay? But be careful there for a snare of the enemy to catch you in a way that it takes you away from praying or coming to God. That's what David did. The first thing he did, he says, God, I'm a wicked man. God, I've got it wrong. And he was open and he was transparent about those things. I think another reason why we battle to be honest is the fear of rejection. Maybe you're just a small group facilitator in church, and now you feel the Holy Spirit is leading you to repent of something, maybe to a leader. And now you think, but won't they fire me? What will my husband or my wife say? What will my children say when I'm honest about certain things in my life? But you see, we learn about someone's character, someone's integrity. And you know, I've always seen, because it's a biblical principle, whenever we are honest, people will look up to you. It might hurt in the short run. It might have dire consequences. Joseph, to mention one, he didn't do anything wrong when his master Potiphar's wife wanted him. You know, it says God was with him. God was with him. It wasn't his fault that his brothers sold him as a slave. Okay? God's hand was with him. And even in jail, he didn't lie or something, but he was still sent to jail. Okay? But God justified him. God exalted him. And maybe, sometimes why we battle to be honest is we can worry to look bad or what the consequences might be, what other people might think of us. But I want to encourage you to start by being honest with yourself. Then we can be honest with God and honest with the people around us. We read in Jeremiah 17 verse 9, it says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. Who can understand it? You know, sometimes when we read in newspapers or on the media what's happening in people's lives, we think, but how can someone do something like that? And the thing is, people, I'm not even going to talk too much on that area, but you see, sometimes we believe lies. And the saddest thing is, October, for certain reasons, you see 12-year-olds, 14-year-olds taking their lives. Why? Why do we believe a lie that I'm not good enough, beautiful enough, not good enough in sport, that my future is doomed? And many times, especially with young children, I think, God, couldn't me or the church or someone just had 5 minutes to talk to you, to that person, to break those lies and tell you you're beautiful? But the Holy Spirit helps us with this. I'm going to read to you John 16, verse 7 to 8. But I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him, the Holy Spirit, to you, to be in close fellowship with you. So that's an important part, to be in close fellowship with you. And he, when he comes, will convict the world about the guilt of sin and the need for a savior, and about righteousness and about judgment. He will convict about three things: sin, righteousness, and judgment. You see, I always remember when I was, before I gave my heart to the Lord and I was a young high school boy or so forth, we always thought, now what is, and I'm going to be honest, can you drink a beer or two or four or five? Can you smoke half a cigarette, full cigarette? Can you watch this or that? What is right and what is wrong? And I don't always have the answer for you. To kill and to steal is wrong. Scripture says it directly. But a lot of other things in life, it's kind of gray. So what's the right and wrong? What do you do or don't? That scripture in John is very clear. Jesus said, when I go away and you receive as Christians, as born-again Christians, you're baptized with the Holy Spirit, then the Helper comes. And then it's easy. If we are honest. Not just running away from God, but the moment we are honest, you know, the Holy Spirit will come to us and he will say, listen, you cannot dress like that anymore. Listen, that cigarette will kill you. Listen, it's not about the law, whether it's a drink or two or three. It's about, what does it do to you? So we can use many different examples. But can I have an amen there? Who's still awake?
Amen. Okay? Amen.
The Holy Spirit will convict us. Whether you're addicted to soaps, CPS or PTF, whether it's eating too much, drinking too much, smoking, it's not about big and small sin. It's not about those type of things. But the Helper, he will come and he will lead us into all truth. He will guide us. He will show us the way. In Proverbs 12, verse 22, Scripture says, lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who act faithfully are his delight. God hates lying lips. God really hates it. And God is busy with a big project always. And that is renewing us, changing us for his glory. The Holy Spirit plays an important role there. Learning the real truth about yourself is bound to be a long and uncomfortable process of discovery. I've heard it quite a few times that people that were really, really into a lot of brokenness and hurt and sin, when they come to salvation and the light goes on, it's almost like this huge revelation where they look at their old life and they cannot believe that we, myself, or you, or whoever, were like that. That you believe those lies. That you're dressed in a certain way or something. And then the Holy Spirit comes. He renews us. He cleanses us. Stephen Lawson said, the new birth changes our hearts internally, our lives externally, future eternity. That's the work of God. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. God is into that changing project. I'm going to read to us the last scripture this morning. It's from Luke chapter 18, verse 9 to 14. It says, he also, this is Jesus speaking, he also told this parable to some of we trusted, okay, let me restart. He also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous, and treated others with contempt. He said, two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, extortionists, unjust, adulterous, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I get. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift his eyes to the heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. Jesus, knowing people's hearts, knowing the things we battle with, he tells the story. Tax collector and the Pharisee. In people's minds, the tax collectors were people notoriously sinful, people cheating. They were working with the Romans, probably dealing and smuggling and a few things like that, where the Pharisee is supposed to be just. What do we see the Pharisee do? He stands there before God. God, I've got the scale of righteousness. God, I'm on this level. I wrote the exam. I've got an A+. He asks for nothing of God because he thinks he needs nothing. He stands there, he wrote the exam of life, and he gave himself an A+. He said, God, at least I'm not like those guys. I'm not as bad as they are. And then there's the tax collector. He stands there, beats his on his chest. Doesn't even stand with the other people. He feels too bad about himself. He doesn't have pure hands, clean hands or a pure heart. He knows he's in trouble. Don't stand with the other people. He doesn't even look up to heaven. He's just like, God, have mercy on me. I'm wrong. He confesses that he's a sinner. Okay? And scripture says that guy, he's the guy that will leave and go to his house and he will be righteous. I remember many times in my life, I thought like, God, I battle with stuff, but at least I'm not as bad as they are. Sometimes we think like that. But people, this Pharisee, he was still busy deceiving himself. He wasn't really walking in the light. He just wanted to show the people, I do this and I do that, and I'm not as bad as they are. But this tax collector, he came being real honest before God, honest with himself. His emotions, remember Jesus is telling this story. Everything shows that he knows he's a dead man, that he's in trouble. And Jesus ends and he says, listen, this guy is the guy who will be justified. If we can use a commentary on the scripture, I want to read to you, did I say the last scripture? I'll say it again. From James chapter 4, verse 8. It says, come close to God, and God will come close to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, for your loyalty is divided between God and the world. Let there be tears for what you have done. Let there be sorrow and deep grief. Let there be sadness instead of laughter, and gloom instead of joy. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up in honor. A beautiful place of being honest with God. Place of being honest in our lives, okay? And here we can see these two men. The Pharisee probably came many more times to the temple and did the same thing. But the tax collector, the guy that was honest, there was the opportunity for healing. There was the opportunity for deliverance. There was the opportunity for his life to change. I'm going to use the example and I'm just going to say, make if I'm a lady, otherwise my story isn't going to work. But let's use the example that I've got quite a bad skin problem. So now I use makeup. See, Bernard is laughing. That's why I can't say myself. So I don't use makeup. I'm just sweating today. But nevertheless, now I've got pimples and it's hurting and it's really, I've got a lot of trouble, but I'm trying to hide it with makeup. Apparently, it helps the ladies a bit. Okay? And then, and I'm thinking other stuff about my own children and I just want to laugh about the difference between boys and girls, but let me not get distracted. I know it's hot and you hopefully think, can I just finish? But you see, if I've got that problem and I phone my friend, say in Vindu, who's a dermatologist, okay? Someone that is really in the position to help me. And I say this to that person, listen, I've got one or two red spots here and it's bit of an issue, what can I do? What help can you give me? That person will not really be able to help because of the lack of information you give. But you see, if you phone that friend that's a skincare specialist and you tell that person, listen, my whole face is red with sore stuff that is hurting and it's itching and there's a lot of problems and I probably ate this and every time I ate this, this happens and I'm totally honest. Which of the two scenarios is the one where you can get the advice, the medical aid or advice to help you? You see, many times in life, that is just the example. Many times, there's a whole iceberg in our life somewhere, and we want to tell a sentence and two, and we hope we can get healed. But we're lying to ourselves. And I'm not trying to push you this morning to say, just stand up and say everything that's wrong in your life. No, the Holy Spirit will lead you. But what I am saying is that when we start, stop lying to ourselves, and whenever we are honest, sometimes I know in my own life, I was so angry that I couldn't sleep. Or I was so offended that I couldn't sleep. Or sometimes someone's heart is so broken that you just cannot sleep. But we try to hide. We try to look strong. And we just suffer and suffer. But the moment we can get to that place of saying to ourselves, I need help. I've got a problem here. God, this is where I stand. This is what's happening in my life. Then God can come and miracles, I believe, can start to happen. The Bible might hurt you with the truth, but it will never comfort you with a lie. And that's something that I love so much. Sometimes we read scripture and we read something about David or Samson or someone, Peter saying to God, Lord, I'll never do this. Jesus knew all the time. He would sell him out, lie and cheat and whatever. As we read scripture, that very, very sharp, two-edged sword will cut. And you've got two options. You can either avoid that, or you can use that opportunity. Come, bring your heart before God. Be honest with God. Maybe you need to even take it a step further and you need to go to your small group leader, to your pastor, to a trusted accountability partner and say, listen, I've got a problem. I've got an issue. I've got a hurt. I've got something in my life that we need to sort out. Because between me and I, that thing gets lost. We just want to put it there on the shelf and hope that it will never ever be too big problem. So church, this morning, I'm going to cut it a bit short for the sake of your salvation, for the sake of loving church. Thank you, Karl. I can see. That's a thank you. That's enough confirmation for me. This morning, forget about the heat. Forget about that there's not electricity. The name of the sermon, there isn't a name up there. It's a different story today. But I want to leave you with one thing, to be honest. To be honest with yourself, to be honest with God, to be honest with others. I'm going to end off, there's not going to be music here today, but I want you, those of you who need to go, you can go, I'll pray for us, and you can go softly, please drive safely, have a wonderful weekend. But for the rest, if you feel it's your day today, maybe just sit here for a moment or two and say, God, I'm going to go and I'm going to be honest with my wife. My brother or my sister, my siblings, whoever needs it, I'm going to go back and I'm going to make a decision to be more honest about who I am, about where I stand, what I battle with. And if you are here still and you feel you need to pray and you feel, listen, this thing is so big in my heart, just sit for a moment or five. I'll stay here behind. I'll be the strong guy who stays in the hot church. I'd love to. Okay? But please don't walk away. If you feel there's something you want to pray about, I would love to pray with you this morning. But think about those scriptures. The Bible is full of so much truth. Jesus is the Son of God. We can go, the list is long. Truth, the truth will set us free. Take that home. And if you feel led by the Holy Spirit, put your hand up and say, I'm going to walk in the truth. I'm going to make a decision to be honest. Amen. Lord God, we worship you this morning. We thank you, Lord God. Holy Spirit, none of us can say that we are perfect. None of us can say that we have no sin. We just have to be honest with ourselves and acknowledge, Lord God, that every day we live, it's by your grace. Lord, I pray that, Holy Spirit, you will lead us into the truth. Holy Spirit, that still small voice will be a strong voice that we can hear and acknowledge in our lives. And when you speak to us, that we will obey, that we will be full of truth, Lord God. That, Father, that we will not tell lies or, as in Afrikaans, white lies, and stuff like that, Lord God. Yes, Father, that we will be people where our yes will be our yes and our no will be our no. Father, I pray that we will start to be honest with ourselves, Lord God, regarding our past, regarding where we stand right now, and regarding where we are going, Lord. Lord, you know exactly, with your whole being, what is happening in our lives. But sometimes, Lord, we are fooling ourselves. Ons sit die oogklappe op, Lord God, and we don't want to acknowledge what's happening in our lives. Father, I pray that your light will shine into our hearts, into our minds, Lord God, that it will illuminate our understanding, Lord God, and yes, Lord God, that we will make that decision and pray a prayer where we can say, Lord, lead us into the truth. Holy Spirit, convict me of the sin in my life, Lord God, that there can be a process of healing. In Jesus' name.